thanks for having me. I'm going to talk about .NET MAUI, what is .NET MAUI. And I talked to Eric two years ago, and he asked me to do a talk on Xamarin. So now Xamarin is evolving. So I now had to dive into .NET MAUI, and hopefully I can teach you a lesson or two. I've got a big agenda, but hopefully we are going to go through it quickly. First of all, a little bit, what is .NET MAUI, where does it come from? A little bit over the project structure, the new multi-targeting, which is new for .NET MAUI. I'm going to show you all the available pages, layouts, and controls. Also a little bit on how you can customize your controls. I'm going to talk a little bit about XAML or C#, which one are you using for your front end, a little bit about MVVM, navigation, IOC, and also the platform APIs, and a small bit about the community toolkit. Okay, first I'm John Bijstebos. I'm a freelance .NET / Xamarin developer, hopefully only .NET MAUI from now on, but we'll see. I'm developing with Xamarin for 6 or 7 years now. I started back in the days in 2009 with Monotouch, which was the first version. Then I skipped it and I came back later. And for the past 5 years, I'm doing it as a freelancer. And so far so good. So I'm only dedicated working on Xamarin projects. Okay, so what is .NET MAUI? It stands for Multi-Platform App UI, and it's basically a cross-platform framework which you can develop native mobile and desktop apps, which you can develop with C# and also a bit of XAML. And you can run it on each platform. But basically it covers Android, iOS, macOS, and Windows, and that's all from a single shared code base. And the power of .NET MAUI is really that it unifies all the platform-specific APIs into one, so you don't have to jump in too much platform specifics, only if you want to develop something that isn't available on each platform, but you can also dive in each platform natively, so you can go all the way. Okay, so this is a small architecture picture. The difference between .NET MAUI and Xamarin is that .NET MAUI is really embedded in .NET 6. You will also see it further on the presentation with the multi-platform targeting. But now you have a target .NET 6 for Android, iOS, and also for macOS. So the difference is that Xamarin is not on top of .NET anymore, but it's now embedded in. So you have everything you have with .NET 6, and on top of that, you have all the platform-specific .NET versions. And on top of that, you have the .NET MAUI layer. And on top of that, you can develop your own app code. And on the bottom, you see the runtimes. So it's really a native app that runs natively on each platform. Okay, this is the single project structure. Previously with Xamarin, you had head projects for each platform. So each time you want to run your app on a different platform, you have to switch to that project and set it as a starter project. And now it's more unified. You just have one platform. One project to run on all platforms. And for me, a big step is that the images, you don't have to resize all your images and copy all your fonts on each platform project to get it up and running. It's now all in this one single project, and everything is compiled and copied to all the platform specifics. That's the shared assets folder. And the start point is the MAUI program. And it's, as you can see here, there is a MAUI app builder. It's almost the same as the ASP.NET core builder. And at least the syntax is quite the same. So if you are familiar with ASP.NET Core, then you'll understand the syntax quite easy. Okay, the multi-platform targeting. Now the CS project file has all the platforms that of all the frameworks that you want to have available. And now you don't have to switch which project you want to start, but you can just on the debug button, you can select your framework or just all the options available, like your Android local devices or emulators or your iOS local devices or simulators. So you don't have to switch the platforms anymore. And you can also configure which framework you want to make available on your project. With the multi-platform targeting, you don't have a different project anymore where you can use all the Android-specific code or all the iOS-specific code. So now we can use the preprocessor directives if you want to code a little bit of platform-specific code. Like in this example, if you want to do something on Android, but you also noticed back on the previous slide that there is a platforms folder. And each class you create in the Android folder is only available if you target .NET Android. And there you always can use all the Android-specific stuff. A third option is to create a file name-based multi-targeting. You need to change a little bit in your CS project, and you can name it .android.cs, for example, and then the compiler knows that that he needs to take .NET Android, and you have access to all the Android code. An advantage above the platform, the folder-based multi-targeting, is that you can combine all your code for each platform together instead of putting it in separated folders. And also the power of partial classes becomes handy now. So that's a good thing to know and use. The pages, the options to choose for pages is similar to XAML forms. You have a normal content page, a flyout page that is just with a menu button and a menu sliding in, which is using the native component for that. You have the navigation page. If you want to navigate, you have to wrap all your pages in a navigation page, and automatically you'll see a navigation bar on top, which handles the back button and also the page title by default for you. And then you have also the tapped page, which also uses the native functionality for that. Then there are a few layouts. We have the stack layout, and now in .NET MAUI there are two improved versions of the stack layout, the horizontal one and the vertical one. Basically, all the children get stacked below or next to each other. That's quite easy layout to use. With the absolute layout, you have to define where all your children are positioned inside that layout. With the grid layout, you define some columns and rows, and you have to define on all your children in which column or row or columns slash rows they need to be presented in. And then you have the flex layout. That one just stretches how much space it has and then goes to the next row or column, just which direction you'll decide to use. And last is the bindable layout. It's not really a visible layout to use, but it's just some kind of repeater. So if you want to repeat some code for a list of objects, or then you can use the bindable layout if the collection view is just a bit too heavy for your needs. So out of the box, there are a lot of controls available for .NET MAUI. It's all similar than the XAML forms ones. A new one is the Blazor web view, which Gerald will talk about. And some of the new controls are the path, the lines that are really drawn controls, and they use the native graphics for that. So if you don't want to use a native control like a button or a progress bar or anything else, you can also create a custom control with just the graphics engine of each platform. As I mentioned, each control is really a native control, and in this picture you see that there is a MAUI button control, which has an interface, and for each platform there is a handler for it. And what the handler does is just some kind of mapping for all the options slash properties the button contains, the MAUI button contains. Rewrites it and uses the native, for example, UI button for iOS or the App Compat button for Android. So if you want to align the text inside a button, then the button handler for Android knows how to do that on an Android button. And the button handler for iOS knows how to use it on the UI button, for instance. Okay, so there are different ways of customizing your controls. The first one is a handler. Like in the previous slide, the button handler. If, for example, you have a control that is a native control on iOS, and it doesn't have an implementation similar on Android, you can write a handler for it, and you can also use that native control. You can wrap it in a bindings library, and with the handler you can access it in your front end as well. The handlers is the evolution or the renderers from Xamarin Forms. It's quite large, so you have to define everything that controls needs to have as an option. For example, if you use a behavior, which is also an option, you can just pinpoint on one functionality and add it to a control. For example, aligning an image inside a button. You can create, for example, a behavior for that one. And if you use that functionality in a handler, then it would work for all buttons. But if you create a behavior, then it only works on buttons that where you attach that behavior to. If you're using styles, you can just use the available properties on a control, but you can create certain styles for it. For example, if you create a primary button style, you can reuse that style all over again in your application. So that way you can really declare some kind of style dictionary, which you can use throughout your application. There are two types of styles, implicit and explicit styles. One is just for all the controls. For example, if you create a style for a button, that it works on all buttons, or you give it a name and then it only works if you attach that style to that control. Then we also have the Visual State Manager. Each control has a set of states. For a button, for example, you have the disabled state, the enabled normal state. You can also create an in-progress button, for example, then you create an extra state. For each state, you can also add some styles to it, so you only have to define once how a certain state of a certain control should look like, and you can reuse it throughout your application. Then we also have control templates and the XAML markup extensions, and I will talk about it later on in the presentation. Okay, so now we have XAML or C#. You can really choose a lot of options on how to develop your front end. The basic options are XAML and C#. On the left side, you see an example of XAML. That's the front-end language of .NET MAUI, but it's also an option to do it in C#. It's just your favor. Whatever you want, you can do all the same stuff with it. So it's just what you find easiest to do. There is also a C# markup extensions library, which makes the C# front-ending a little bit more fluent. So it's easier readable, less lines of code, less cluttery. So that's also an option to use. Another option is to use Comet, but it's still in beta. By default, .NET MAUI renders everything as a native control. And it's eventing on updating the UI. But that's a quite heavy and a static approach. With Comet, they tried a different approach, and that's more the same kind of approach Flutter uses. So on every frame drawing, it executes the code, and if the code has changed, for example, the count value has changed, the next time drawing the screen, which happens 60 times per second, for example, it automatically knows that it has a new count and it will be drawn on the screen differently. So it's a quite more fluent and performant option to use. So hopefully we'll see more about Comet in the future. At least I hope so. Okay, a little bit about MVVM and data binding and commands. Who all know the MVVM pattern? Hopefully everyone know. Okay. Just a basic explanation for this. It's just a way of separating your concerns. So on one side you have the view, and the view is only should only contain any presentation kind of code. So how does this control look like? How should this look like, etc. And what data should this control show is part of the view model. So it's more like the logic behind the presentation. So which data should I take, and where do I need to show it? And behind that, we have the business logic and the data. So that's handling, fetching the data, modeling all your data on how you want to give it back to the view model. All the arrows you see is just some kind of eventing mechanism. So if you do a binding from your view to your view model on a certain property called text, for example, if you change the text inside your view model, a property changed event will be triggered, and the view will be subscribed to that one, and then it knows that everywhere that binding is used, it should update the UI. There are a lot of binding modes. The default one is just one-way binding, so it's only if the view model changes, the view will be notified and not the other way around. But if you have an input kind of control, like the text field or the entry control, then the user can also input any data, and also the view model has to be notified about that. So then you should use the two-way binding. But basically, it's just some kind of event mechanism on all the property changes back and forth. This is an example of the more old and more static way. If you have a label and an entry, you go to the code behind page of your main page, for example. And every time the entry text changes, for example, you can change all the other elements used on the page. So this is without the MVVM pattern. This is more the basic stuff. If you want to have all your logic in your page code behind, which you shouldn't do, but it is possible, of course. If you go the MVVM way, then you see on the main page we have a binding context, and there you set up the connection with the view model from the page. And in the XAML example, you see binding full name, for example. that's the binding to the full name property of your binding context. And in this case, we set the binding context to our main page view model. And here in the setter of the first name, you see that the property change gets invoked. And that way the page gets an event that the full name has changed and it will also update the UI. Yeah, as you can see, the setters are quite large. So this way, without using any tools or any frameworks, it's quite a lot of code. Of course, you can easily just refactor this quite a bit by creating a view model base with a set property method. But still, you have to write down all your properties in quite some lines, and you have to call the set property method. Also with the commands, it's quite a lot of code still. So what I found a while back is that there is a community toolkit of .NET which has an MVVM version. And this way, with some annotation and partial classes, all the code gets generated for you. So now you only have to create a variable first name, and it automatically generates the first name property with the iNotify property change interface implemented. And you can also implement commanding that way. So now you don't have to create a property, a command property anymore, but just the property, the method clear in this example. And with the relay command annotation, the clear command will property will get generated automatically. So this way you can really lose a lot of lines of code, and it saves you a lot of work. I will also show you in the demo how this works. Yeah, then a bit of navigation. As I mentioned, if you want to navigate, you have to wrap your main or your content page or any page in a navigation page, as you see on the left image. And automatically, if you do that, you get the navigation bar here. And if you navigate to the to another page, you automatically also get the go back button in the navigation bar. If you don't wrap your main page in a navigation page, then the page navigation property never get instantiated, so you are not able to navigate. And the navigation, the iNavigation interface is the navigation property that contains the navigation stack. So you always know where you have navigated to and from, and you can always go back by popping a page or go forward with pushing a page to the navigation stack. And then there's also a difference between normal navigation and model navigation. With model navigation, then a new page gets positioned as a model on top of your page. And in that page, you can also navigate back and forth again. But that has a different navigation stack. So that's why there are two types of navigation stacks. As I mentioned, is that the page now has the navigation property, but we want to move our logic, presentation logic, to our view model. But the view model doesn't have a reference to your page. So how do we now navigate from one page to another? You should abstract the logic on which page you are. So ideally, you create a navigation service which you can use in your view model to abstract on which page you are right now. And that way you can push and pop your pages back and forth. And you can always develop this yourself, of course, but there are a lot of frameworks available already that support it. One is FreshMVVM, and another one is Prism. I'm currently using Prism, but also FreshMVVM is quite a good one for this. So you don't have to abstract all this logic yourself, but yeah, someone already invented the wheel, so why should you? Here's just a small example if you want to do it yourself. Here I have a simple property navigation, and it just looks at the current page, which is the main page, and is the navigation property instantiated, then we can navigate. Otherwise, we throw an exception or anything. And as you can see here, we do just do on the navigation, do the push async, and here we do the pop async to just go back and forth with navigating. Okay, in Xamarin Forms, there was not by default inversion of control of dependency injection available. That's not totally true, because there was a dependency service, but not with constructor injection. So each time you wanted to use that, you always had to use a framework for that. There were some frameworks available, so there was not an issue. But in .mawi, it's baked in by default. The MAUI app builder, as I showed before, has a services property. And on that services property, which is a service collection, you can register all your services, view models, pages, and everything can be injected in your pages and view models. And everything you register, you can inject to as well. So this way, you can really separate out all the all your code and all the logic. Yes. Okay. With Xamarin Forms, there was a great set of platform APIs under the name Xamarin Essentials, which has been moved over to .NET MAUI. I don't know if it's still called Essentials or not, but it's just a library which contains a lot of platform APIs, like a file picker or choosing your context, so you don't have to develop all the logic on each platform, but it's already been developed for you. So if you want to take a screenshot, you don't have to develop the Android and iOS and the Windows code for that, but it's already available in the Essentials library, which is available by default in .NET MAUI. I will also show that in the demo a little bit. Here's a small example on how to use it. One of the APIs, platform APIs, is the iConnectivity. With this API, you can check if the device where your application is running on has internet connection or not, or is using Wi-Fi if you want to download heavy stuff, etc. You can inject it by registering the interface, or you can also use the singleton approach, which I showed on the bottom by the geolocation. It's also quite easy to get the geolocation of your device by this.
Can you look into that? I prefer the last one, because it's way easier for unit testing.
The last one?
Yeah, if you use dependency injection through an interface.
Yeah. Yeah, the second one is not, the static one is not testable. Yeah, that's also great that now constructor injection is embedded in .NET MAUI, so you can use it out of the box, because that makes everything really testable. And Xamarin Essentials didn't have the interface. You had to install another plugin that generated the interfaces. But now they chose to create the interfaces as well.
I have another question. Eric, do you want to send me the cube?
Oh, sorry.
Sleeping.
Yes.
Cool.
All right, my question is, when you are injecting the platform APIs, let's say you need to use Bluetooth, right?
Yeah.
So it will be registered in your app when you download that the app will want to use Bluetooth. Where do you handle the code and the flow of requesting to use one of the permissions, and then the user not giving the permission and retrying, etc.? Do you do it in the builder, or you have to
do something else? You don't do it in the builder. I can go back one slide. There's also a permissions platform API, so you can just check or request any permission you need. So if you need, for example, the camera permission, if you want to take a photo, then you could request manually if the permission is granted or not. But each platform API is also by default checking it. So if you use the camera platform API and you want to take a photo and you haven't requested the permission, then the camera platform API will request it for you. So you don't really have to think about it, but you do need to handle if the permission is denied or not.
Right.
Because then you can re-request it again. But there's also an option, at least it is on Android, I don't know for sure if it's also in iOS, that you deny it for always. You cannot really override that in your code. So then the platform just denies it for always. So what you should or could do in that case is if the permission is denied and you request it again and it gets denied again, then you know that it's denied forever. You can just give a pop-up and open the settings of your device, the settings page where you can change that setting back.
Yeah, and how do you handle that case? Is it through an exception that you then need to catch?
If the permission is not granted, then a permission not granted exception will be
found. Okay, right.
Or something similar. I don't know the exact phrase, but.
Yeah, so you need to have a bit of boilerplate code always when you want to use one of the platform APIs, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
To wrap it up.
Or you just call it manually, and then you don't have to handle exceptions, because then you get a permission result, and then you can check what the permission result is. It's denied or allowed for once. So you don't have to do try catching.
Is that the static way example that you were showing, or
you can use both?
Yeah, but the example that you just said, calling it directly, is it only applicable to the static way?
No, for both.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Because they are both the same. It's just the geolocation default is some kind of singleton mechanism which returns the interface. Cool. Okay, the MAUI Community Toolkit. At the back is the one inventing it, partially. it's a community toolkit. There's also a .NET Community Toolkit and the Xamarin Community Toolkit. So now there's also the MAUI Community Toolkit, because we can't get enough of community toolkits, which is developed and maintained by the community, of course. And what does it contain? It's just a lot of commonly used practices or functionalities, behaviors, handlers, views, extension methods, as simple as you can go and as difficult as you can go. So someone did tell me, if you are copying something beautiful from project A to B, stop it and add it to the community toolkit. So that's really the power of the community toolkit. So if you guys are using .NET MAUI in the future, go have a look at what is all inside the community toolkit, because a lot of things are already developed for you, so you don't have to do it yourself. Okay, cool. Then it's time for the demo. We still are on time, so that's cool. Yes. I just made a simple application, which I implemented a simple behavior just to show you how to do this. And I'm just using some kind of platform API. So I'll walk you through this app while it's building and running. So here we have the MAUI program with the builder, create builder. And here is the service collection. And inside the service collection, I registered my main page and my view model, and also my media picker, because that's the platform API I want to use, because I want to take a photo. And this way, inside the main page, you can inject your view model and just set your binding context, and this way your main page and main page view model are connected. And if a property change event is triggered, then the page will handle it. The app is now running. So I just created a simple app with a button take photo and a blur level. If we change the slider, then the images goes blurry. Depending on the value that you selected. I will have a look at the main page XAML with what it's all about. Here we have the image, which is binding to a photo URL. Now, by default, we just have a static image shown. And here you see that I attached a behavior, and that's the image blur behavior. And therefore, a little bit of platform-specific code is required. We will have a look at that later on. And here we set the radius, which is the value on how blurry it should get. And this is a binding, not to our binding context, so not to our view model, but I changed the source to the blur level slider. So it directly has a connection to our slider control, and it takes the value and it sets the value in the radius of the behavior. So down here we have the slider, and I'm also binding the blur value to the view model. And also, we have a label to display the blur level in a string value, as you can see here. And this also binds directly to the slider and not to the view model, just to show you that that is an option to do. Now let's have a look at the behavior. It's quite a simple behavior. It has just one property, the radius, so the radius of the blur level. And when the radius changes, then I want to apply the behavior to the platform view, because this is a, as you can see on the name, it's a shared code file. So this doesn't have any access to the specific platforms. So that's why I've created a partial class down here. And on each platform-specific behavior, I'm implementing that that method. So if we go to Android, for example, then here we have the apply behavior to platform view. And here we can check the Android version, for example, because otherwise it's not working. And if I hover over this platform view, you see that it's of type image view, which is a an Android image view. So here you see the Android namespace. So inside this code file, I have access to all the Android specific code, because it's only using the .NET Android code for this. And if we go to iOS, you see that we have a UI image view, which is the image view equivalent for iOS instead of the image view for Android. And
question?
Yeah.
How does it know it's specific for Android or iOS? Is it the yep. name, the .android, or?
If you use these folders, the platform folders, then by default it knows that inside the Android folder you only have access to .NET Android. But on the Microsoft docs you can find some code to add to your CS project file. That's here. You just create an item group with a condition: if your target framework is Android, then compile all the .android.cs files and all others, set it to none.
Everything that ends with .android.cs is targeting Android.
Yeah, that's correct. In each folder.
Clear.
Yeah. But this is not added to your CS project by default, so you have to add it yourself. But you can also just move all the Android behavior class inside the platform Android folder. Then it should also work. But I prefer this, because then you have all the logic for this type of behavior together. Yeah, so it's more maintainable. Otherwise it gets a little bit cluttery. Okay, I was hoping that my Android phone was cooperating, so Just give me a sec because it got disconnected. I'll reconnect it again. Good one. Yes. So here on my debug button, you can also see that I can choose my target framework. And you, if I was connected to a Mac, which I'm not now, then you also see all the iOS simulators your Mac connected Mac has installed. So you can also just run an iOS simulator from Windows. There's also the remote simulator, so it got remote back to your Windows, so you get a screen on your Windows machine, which is just a remote simulator. If I now go to Android local devices, it should start my phone. Just give it a sec. Yeah, cool. Okay, so now you see that it's looking the same as on Windows. I already closed my Windows one. So you don't have any specific front end anymore. It's working on all the platforms. I can't show you iOS right now, but believe me, it does work. Yeah, if you go take a photo, then you now also see it's in Dutch, but you have to believe me. It's asking for permission, and if you say don't allow, I can set a breakpoint in the view model to show you. View model. Oh, there's already a breakpoint. If I say don't allow, you'll see that it goes to an exception. It does, yeah. Camera permission was not granted, denied. And if you do it again, I hope it did last time. So if I request it again, it will ask again. If you say don't allow, then it will allow never. I can also do only once, and the next time it will request it again. But for now, I'll do it during this app. So I'll take a photo of everyone. Say hi, cheese. Cool. So it's quite easy to just create a photo. The only thing I did is just inject the iMedia picker right here. And down here, I check if capture is supported, because not, you should believe it, but not every phone supports taking photos, or not every platform, at least. And if it is supported, then I just say take a photo, and you get a photo result back with an URL. And also this image can get even more blurry. It's already blurry, but yeah, you can see that it's also working on this image and not only the static image. So with just two lines of code, I took a photo inside our app, and it doesn't have any specific code, which is really cool.
I have a question. Can you use the
So I actually noticed that there is a difference between the code that you showed us on your machine and for the phone, which is the background. So the one was black, and now it's white.
You are a little bit quick. Yeah, by default, .mAUI also supports different app themes, like dark and light mode, which I could show you here. I just set a app theme binding on the button color, which in default, theme, I use the primary color, which is this blue purplish color. And if you go to dark mode, then it should show white. So if I now put my phone in dark mode, which is over here, you automatically see that the app changes. Nice. And now the button is white. So this way you can also implement your dark and light mode quite easily. And you can, of course, also put all this styling in a style dictionary for reuse. But it's this easy to handle dark mode as well.
Yeah, it's great. It's respecting the platform.
Yeah, yeah. One other thing I also wanted to show is XAML Hot Reload. Hopefully the demo gods are nice on me today, but if I don't do any typos. If I save this one, then automatically you see that the app doesn't have to be restarted or recompiled, but it changes the button back to yellow. And yeah, you can do all changes as you want. You don't have to save it, and it gets updated. So this way you can really quickly implement your front end because it's visually updated directly. Which yeah, makes developing the front end quite easy and quite fast. I am also going to show the property changed stuff. So here we have the observable property. I only added a variable underscore photo URL, but I added the observable property annotation. And with the MVVM community toolkit, I also have access to the photo URL property, which I didn't type or create it myself. But if we go inside this one, we see that this code is generated for this property by default. And this way you also see that the on property changed and changing events are triggered. And there is also a partial or virtual, I don't know if it's partial or virtual, method on photo URL change, which you can override on your view model. If the property has changed, you can act on it as well. And this is the same for the take photo command. To go there and take photo command, if we that's generated as well, we see it here. It's an async relay command. And here also the it's quite a bit. And there's also a function if it's I didn't implement it here. You can also add to the annotation a can execute method or property, and it also handles that by default. It gets generated by default as well. Cool. I think that's it. Oh, I have to go all the way.
One more question. In Xamarin, for images and icons, you had to make all the different resolutions.
Yeah.
So that's why I prefer to use SVGs. Is that now baked in, or is it still a problem? Or
yeah,
a problem? It's not a problem, but
for Xamarin Forms, you had two options: or you resize the PNGs or JPEGs or any format you want manually in all the required resolutions, or you could use vector drawables for Android or PDFs, which are scalable. So then you only have to convert it to one file per platform. But there was a framework resizitizer, which handles that on compile time, I guess, which just converted it to all required resolutions, etc. And that's now baked in .NET MAUI.
Okay.
So if you now go to your single project in your shared assets folder, you can put in an SVG. And if you compile it, you can see that in the app package, it generates all the resolution PNGs. Yeah.
Because I tried resizitizer, but I think it's not supported or it's not working anymore, I think, but recently, but there were so many forms, of course.
Okay.
So I guess for MAUI,
it does work on MAUI.
Okay, fine.
Yeah,
nice.
Luckily.
Yeah. That saves a lot of headache.
Yeah.
I actually have two questions. One of them is, what's the status of the .NET MAUI? Is it production ready or just?
I'm using it in production right now.
Oh,
So yeah, it depends on your needs. In some areas, Xamarin.Form is a little bit more mature, of course, because .mau is quite new. But theoretically, it's the same. It's just evolved and changed. And yeah, everything you can do with Xamarin.Form, you should be able to do with .NET MAUI. Yeah, but it's still young, so of course there are still a little bit less stable than forms, but I already use it in production, so it is possible, but yeah, depends on your needs.
Yeah, and the second question also is that, I mean, when you say our needs, I mean, what kind of applications we can build with this? I mean, what's the level of customization? If you want to, I don't know, so this is from the simple one, I'm like, I want to make a button like round, or I don't know, sharp, or make it in like different shapes. Nothing, not like the, you know, default components of every platform. I just want to have really something really customized. Is it easy or really difficult? It's better to avoid it.
More customization is more difficult by default.
Okay.
Yeah, but I think the new architecture of .MAUI allows you to customize easier and more than Xamarin.Form's was able to. Yeah.
I will talk a little bit about that.
Thank you. But that was it.
Okay, cool.
Any more questions?
You said that you're using it in production. Are you happy with the startup time and the application size? What about application size especially?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think the startup time really got improved with .NET MAUI. But the at least for Android, you can customize some settings to play with the size of the generated package, but it also, yeah, you have to weigh in if you want the startup size or the lower package size, or there's also an option to meet in the middle. You have to put in the .NET framework, so yeah.
How big is it?
I have some link for you with more details on what all the what the file size takes and what's inside and why it is that large, in your opinion, perhaps. So I can give it to you.
Okay, but comparing to Xamarin.Form's.
Yeah, comparing to native development, for example. But I don't know if it also compares with Xamarin.Form's. But I'll have a look at it later on.